Highbridge, a division of Recorded Books, presents Bibliomysteries Volume 3 by Robert Olin Butler, John Harvey, Lisa Unger, and Simon Brett. Read by Paul Woodson and Carrie Coelho. The Hemingway Valise by Robert Olin Butler. Hemingway came and got me in the night, with apologies to my wife. A cold weeknight in early December. He was supposed to be in Lausanne covering the treaty conference. He took me to a small left bank cafe near the Seine, new to me, brightly lit, full of incandescent electricity. "For clarity," he said. It was good, the place, clean, just the two of us at this hour, except for an old drunk hunched at a far table and a woman in a dark coat sitting at the zinc bar. It was only later that the glance registered on me, between him and the woman, exchanged when he and I first came in. I recognized it for what it was after I later noticed her watching him in the mirror that hung behind the bar. Her face was pretty, and it was hardened. She was probably young, technically speaking. Hemingway was young, not far into his 20s, with a soldier's body and a boy's face. I was a decade older, but it felt like far more. He sat me down and ordered Calvados. I followed his lead. More clarity, I assumed. The ardent clarity of brandified apples. We took a first sip and put our glasses on the table. The Calvados was fiery and tart, and something else, like the apples had been lying around for a while in a winter sun. Then Hemingway said, "Hadley has done a terrible thing, a killing thing." Hadley, his wife. I was surprised at his having trouble with his wife. They were clingingly, cloyingly, but convincingly tender with each other, even when they clearly didn't think they were being noticed. Though Hem and I had buddied up pretty well and even had a couple of weeks covering the same war, at first I was surprised as well that he'd come to me with this. I'd met Ernest Hemingway only a few months earlier, in the middle of August, in a bookshop. I'd come back to the city that was so important to the two Christopher Marlowe Cobbs who'd been kicking around in my head for almost a decade. One Cobb was a war correspondent, one was a spy. Both of them were Americans, and I guess that was what held me together. The year was 1922. The Great War was over, the news assignments were intermittent, Silent Cal was president, and apparently interested only in the secrets he kept to himself. The dollar was strong and the franc was weak. So there was time for me and Louise, the American nurse I'd started up with here in Paris in 1915, when she was the boss of all the nurses at the American Ambulance Hospital. She was now a fundraiser for the hospital's reincarnation in a too small space to serve the torrent of American tourists and expatriates. We'd gotten married last fall at the Chapelle Americaine off the Champs-Élysées, and we had a little place on the left bank, a third-floor walk-up on the Rue Madame. I was trying to write a novel. Hemingway was, too. It was a hell of a bookshop. Shakespeare and company. You stepped in and it felt more like the personal library across from the billiard room in the mansion of some American business tycoon. If such a mug happened to have serious taste in literature. The center of the place was as wide open as a sitting room, with overstuffed chairs and black and white Serbian rugs, but surrounding you the walls were made up entirely of books, their shelves shoe-top low to ceiling high, insisting that you browse them. Mostly they were the books of the modern gang, from James and Hardy and Yeats to Stein and Wolfe and Fitzgerald, and even the boys you had to read one step ahead of the morality police, D.H. Lawrence and James Joyce. Pyramided on a little shrine of a table in the midst of the sitting space were the few copies remaining of the most dangerous of the modernly immoral books. Joyce's Ulysses, thick as a randy man would hope his book would be, and deceptively serene-seeming in its Aegean blue cover. The one stretch of wall stuck with the room's fireplace was, in place of books, bespangled with the images, photographic and lithographic, of all these same literary stars, watching us riffle their pages. The shop was owned and run by a small, handsome woman who seemed both as tough and as sweet as my own Louise, though my wife was still partial to dresses and wore her hair bunned up beneath her wide-brimmed hats. Sylvia Beach, however, kept her hair full as a boxwood but bobbed jawline short, and the day I met her she was wearing a man's cut velvet jacket and an oversized parody of a boy's first bow tie. She and my wife hit it off right away. I know they did, because after the three of us introduced ourselves and shared a little of our feature section backstories, including my substantial history as a newsman and insubstantial history as a nascent novelist, Sylvia made a move to take me into the center of the sitting area and introduce me to some regulars. But as soon as she sighted our prey, she abruptly held up. She tucked her hand inside my arm and said, low, "Sorry, the boys are presently occupied." She nodded at two men leaning at each other from facing chairs within easy nose-punching distance, talking volubly. "Ezra," she said, "is once again telling Ernest how to write. Ex cathedra. Give them a few moments while I resume with your beautiful wife." So I listened to both conversations in fragments. The gentleman before me. "To cut, dear boy, ravenously to cut. Your beard, old man?" The latter speaker, bare-chinned but mustachioed, would turn out to be Hemingway. The other man, who would be Ezra Pound, had a diabolic point to his beard. "Your every unnecessary word," Pound replied. "The ladies behind me?"
"Happy August 18th, Miss Beach." "Ah, my dear, I somehow knew you would be aware."
My wife had already made me aware immediately upon our arising this morning. Today was the second anniversary of the enactment of the 19th Amendment, though my wife had yet to be home during an election. Shortly, Pound flopped backwards in his chair, slid his butt abruptly forward till he was sitting on his spine, grasped the knob on the ebony cane leaning against his chair, and thumped the stick once, sharply on the floor. Hemingway laughed. It must have been a characteristic conversation-pausing gesture from Pound, for almost at once, after a hasty, "Pardon me, dear," to Louise, Sylvia was again grasping my arm, and now leading me forward. As we moved toward the two men, Hemingway said to Pound, "You know, I'm grateful. I'll even supply the blue pencil." Sylvia slowed us down but kept us going. With a rising twirl of his right hand, Pound replied, "Make it half a dozen." Sylvia and I came into the periphery of their vision. Both men turned to us. Thus I met Ernest Hemingway, and his poet-editor to boot. Hemingway and I picked up the cues from Sylvia's introduction, and we began to talk of newspapers and of war. Shortly, Pound, whose connection to Hemingway seemed pretty rarefied, flourished his way from the chair. He was wearing a cape, and went off to graze Sylvia's shelves. I sat down with my new writer friend. We spoke on of Paris and fiction writing and our wives. Hem nearly leaped from his chair in admiration at the mention of Louise being a nurse. "Did she treat you for a wound?" he asked. The answer was complicated. It was tangled up with some nasty wartime Secret Service business in this very town. I said, "No." He bounced his head in reply and looked away, his eyes seeing something in his mind. In spite of his having said nothing as yet about such a woman, I said, "Did your nurse treat you?" He looked back at me and shot me the smile men smile when you realize you know things about each other without having said them. But before he shaped a reply, there was a woman's voice entering the store. As it turned out, it was Hadley, a plain-faced, plushly huggable woman with bobbed hair. Hemingway looked in her direction. How did his face show a keen pleasure at seeing her, and in the same look, a keen reluctance to let go of the nurse who was bending near him in his head? Somehow. Or maybe this wasn't visible on his face at all. Maybe nurses were just another thing a couple of guys could understand about each other, after finding newspapers and war and Paris and writing in common. Hemingway and his wife exchanged faint, dreamy head rolls with covertly puckering lips. But in the Left Bank Cafe that December, over our Calvados, Hem reworked the harshest of his words about her. "Truly, kid," he said, and he tapped his heart with his index and middle fingers. "Right here, a kill shot." He paused. Not for effect, to ponder his own death, it seemed to me in that knowing part of my buddy brain. But the surface of my mind was assuming it was about Hadley and some other man. It wasn't another man. It was worse. Hem said, "She put every word I've ever written into a valise and allowed them all to be stolen." Ernest Hemingway could, how to say it, exaggerate? About his boxing prowess, he'd said he sparred with Jack Dempsey and the champ had his hands full. About his war wounds as an ambulance driver. He'd claimed to have been given a Carcano rifle and been asked to help out in a trench raid. I knew some things about boxing and about battle and about wartime ambulance drivers. So I hesitated over this new declaration. "Man, oh man," I said. "Every word?" "Originals and copies," he said. His voice broke with this. His eyes glistened in the incandescent light. "3 years of work. Poems, stories, longer stuff. The novel set at the war, the one I began in Chicago. A long story about fishing. That was a fly cast into a teeming stream, kid. It was going to be a novel. And the Paris sketches. One of them has haunted me through this long night. 6 true sentences. Finally true. Just that. 6 of them. But because they were true, they came harder and deeper than a novel." His voice gave out over his 6 sentences. He fell silent. I offered, gently, "The stream is roiled, but things will settle. In a week or two, with your cahier and pencil at a corner table in a bistro, you'll catch them again." He shook his head. "No. That's just it. The true thing happens in the moment you write, like the first touch of a new woman. I've been trying hard to remember, all the way back from Switzerland, but I can't truly shape even one phrase from one of those 6 sentences. It's not about memory." I sat back in my chair. "Maybe so." "Where'd this happen?" I asked. "The Gare de Lyon," he said. "She was taking the express train to join me in Lausanne." "Stolen? Not just lost around the station?" "I'm convinced of it. I was all over the place this afternoon, lost and found, trash bins, but I knew from the moment she told me that it was the Turks." I sat forward again in my chair. This was our shared war, the Greeks and the Turks, the latter throwing out the former from Anatolia to establish a post-war independent Turkey. Though Hem and I were to be a couple of journalistic lone wolves separately on the prowl at the Greco-Turk War, I for the Chicago Post-Express and its syndicate, Hem for the Toronto Star, we'd been happy to share the 100-hour run from Paris to Constantinople on the Simplon Orient Express, and then a few nights of drinking mastica and eating green olives on the roof terrace of the Grand Hôtel de Londres while looking out on Galata and the Golden Horn. Not that either of us found it all terribly golden. Hemingway saw the grimy banks and boat litter of the Chicago River along the banks of the Bosporus. I saw Pittsburgh's smokestacks in the profusion of minarets in Constantinople, similarly emblematic of the big business of the place. Hem thinking the Turks were after him made sense of his coming to me. A few things he'd told me on that roof terrace gave it possible credence. Following too much mastica, followed by too much local Beaumonti beer, he talked about a source he'd developed in Constantinople who fed him choice gossip about the Turkish strongman, hero of independence, and demigod in the making, Mustafa Kemal Pasha. Hem said he knew the inside dope on Kemal, who was exterminating Armenians and loving young boys. Dangerous things to write about. Dangerous even to know. "The Kemal stuff?" I said. "I told you about that," he said, his tone somewhere between an affirming statement and a faintly incredulous question. He'd had way too much Turkish liquor on that particular night. "You did?" I said. "I haven't written about it," he said. "But they have reason to think you're about to. It's the only reason they'd have a tail on me." "In Paris?" "In Paris. I tried to follow up on the rumors a little more openly than was smart. Look, Kemal is a Muslim Mussolini, what Il Duce wants to be in his own country a year or two down the road. You sure they have a man on you? He's not wearing a fucking fez, but yes, swarthy, well put together, a middleweight, about 5'8", tight, dark beard, one shoulder a touch higher than the other, the left one. Seen him at least 3 times since we got back. At Lips and Le Select, once on the street, following at a distance. Hem paused, leaning a little toward me. "You know real well how spies work, right?" He paused again. This last was an elbow nudging me in the ribs, like something already understood between us. I wondered if I'd had too much mastic and beer one night at the Londres myself. I did not recall letting him in on my work for the government. I didn't do that with anyone. But Hemingway was a real writer, by all accounts. Sylvia certainly thought so. And I knew him to be at least a swell reporter. He could read a man. Still, I didn't take the bait, didn't say anything. Let the silence go on. He did, too, for a few moments. And then he said, low, "There may come a time I'll do what I'm pretty sure you're already doing. But for now, I bring this up because I think you're the man who might help me." His eyes had taken on that glisten again. It hurt me to see it. "If you're right about the Turks," I said, "I might be in a better position to be helpful than most mugs." "Thanks," he said, the word rasping at the back of his throat. But I had instant doubts that I could do anything. I said, "My first thought is how big a leap it would be for the Turks to target that valise." His mouth pinched tight. He knew that. The likely alternative thief, a sneak making a quick snatch, would be impossible to track at this point. A bunch of papers would have been an immediate disappointment to a sneak, but the bag apparently hadn't been discarded around the station. Without believing it was the Turks, Hem had to face the likelihood that his manuscripts were floating in the Seine, halfway to the English Channel by now. He and Hadley were dirt poor. This he'd often made perfectly clear. I said, "I take it the valise didn't look ripe?" "Hell no. It was shabby alligator embossed leatherette. Hadley left it in a compartment and went back out to the platform, but it was up on a luggage rack with other people's bags, better bags that didn't get snatched." He'd clearly interrogated Hadley closely. "Somebody was after it," he said. "Were they right?" I asked. "Was there a Kemal story in the bag?" "No, but they wouldn't be wise to that. The only writing they know me for is journalism." "True enough," I said. "But their ignorance ran far deeper. That's the big leap of logic for us to think they did this. The content of the valise was based on a private decision made by your wife. How would they ever know to steal the thing?" Hemingway puffed and sat back in his chair. I sat back too. I said, "Why'd she make that decision? What moved her to put all your manuscripts into that valise to bring them to Lausanne?" "Lincoln Steffens." He paused for a moment to let the name sink in. I nodded. "I've met him," I said. "He was a muckraking American journalist I ran into in Mexico when I went down there for the Post Express in April of 1914 to cover Woody Wilson's invasion at Veracruz. He and my photographer, Bunky Millerman, became drinking buddies." Hem said, "Steph's been a cheerleader since the Genoa conference in April. He's up in Lausanne this week and anxious to see more of my work. I wrote that to Hadley, and now she's put me in this scrape with a lunatic overreaction." His rhetoric had once again heated up over Hadley, and we fell silent for a moment. Then he said, "Say, if they're watching me in Paris, they've been watching me in Lausanne. The conference is full of Turks. the hotel bar included. Steph can get voluble in his praise. Maybe, between the two of us, we said enough to give the thugs a lead. Maybe, I said. At least enough to get them watching Hadley. The valise didn't have to be a target. If your Paris Turk followed her to the station and found her bags left alone, he might have slipped in just to take a look, even without any specific expectations. So, he sees stories and thinks he's caught a break. They don't know literature from journalism. That makes sense. I thought a moment. Then, you have to get back to Lausanne? Yes. When? Tomorrow? Are there notes about Kemal? In the notebooks I carry with me. How many pages? A dozen or so? Do up a Kemal story before you go back to Switzerland. Just quick and dirty. Seal it in an envelope and leave it with Sylvia at the bookstore. Hem's brow had furrowed deeply. Look, at this point, I don't care about the pervert. I figure they're tailing me to find out my sources. If I publish it, they'll be tailing me to put a dagger in my ribs. It's not for publication, I said. In fact, make the story skeptical. Make it sound like you don't believe these rumors. The news is fake. You sympathize with this great man. Even take one of those blue pencils of yours and write, "No story here," and your initials on the top of the first page. Include all the original notes you can that don't give away sources. Hemingway brightened. A trade. Tris speaker for Sad Sam Jones, I said. He laughed out loud. We'd talked baseball. The Indians had robbed the Red Sox in that deal. Who's who? Hem said. You're Cleveland. Damn right. He laughed again. Through this, I'd been aware of the woman at the bar. At Hem's first laugh, her head turned sharply to him. With the second one, as Hemingway lifted his face and took his eyes off me, I glanced at her in the mirror. Her brow was as deeply furrowed as his had been a few moments ago. Her mouth was crimped in distress. I thought, she thinks the laughter's about her, that he's talking about her. She's here to meet him, by arrangement, but she's not a prostitute. When he finished laughing, Hem said, I'll leave the envelope with Sylvia in the morning. You think you can find this guy? I'd shadow you myself and waylay him, I said. But when they don't find what they're looking for in the bag, and don't understand the stuff that's there, they're likely to dispose of it. We can't wait. And they don't even know I'm back in Paris, he said. Right, so he won't know to show up behind you. Damn. But I have some contacts, and his description. He smiled at me. I knew I came to the right man. I hope. Do you think we have a chance? They have to translate. That will take them some time. Not so much for me as some others. I knew what he meant. From what he'd showed me of his work, he was more Western Union than Henry James. I'll do everything I can, I said. And that was that. It was time to end this. I felt sorry for him. I felt sorry for his wife. I was keenly aware of the woman in the mirror, still turned our way. He was going to punish Hadley. I leaned toward him, lowered my voice, but it was a tricky thing, and it was a buddy thing. I found a way to say it without saying it. I'll see if I can help, but we all have to be very careful about what we do now. Yes, he said. Of course. I meant the woman at the bar, but as soon as I said it, I recognized a corollary fear. If the Turks didn't find the story and the notes, they might decide to dispose of more than the irrelevant manuscripts. There would be the matter of Hemingway himself. The dagger in the ribs would be even more effective if it preempted his story rather than punished him for it. I've got to go, I said. Thank you, my friend. I've got Louise waiting for me, I said, still trying to remind him of Hadley in Lausanne. He took in a small, quick breath. A nurse, he said. I knew from previous conversations that the woman in the black coat at the bar could not possibly be his nurse. His nurse had dumped him 3 years ago for an Italian officer. My wife, I said. He paused. He heard me. Right, he said. I went out into the night, and I found myself thinking not of my wife, my nurse, but of a film actress, a film star I'd met and fallen more than a little in love with the year before I met Louise. At the time, she was a famous name on the screen, Celine Bourgani. We met on a doomed British ship in May of 1915. We would both end up in Constantinople. We each had business there. If Mustafa Kemal had by then already become who he now was, he would have wanted each of us dead for our separate missions. Instead, at the time, he was simply off embarrassing the Brits at Gallipoli. I looked back into the bar. Hemingway was standing before the woman in the dark coat, explaining away his laughter, no doubt, commencing a night he would likely never reveal to anyone. I walked away. On the Rue Madame, at our door at the rear of the third floor, in the dark, I found the keyhole with my fingertip and put the key inside very gently. Louise would be sleeping. I opened the door into what we called our everything room, everything but our bedroom. It was our sitting room, our kitchen, even our bathroom, with a steel bathtub hunkered beside the sink. And it was my writing office. Louise had left the secondary gas jet burning low within its mantle. Beneath it was my desk. My time tonight with Hemingway was unsettling in more than one way, not the least of which was that his dilemma tapped a fear I did not know was in me until it began to flow. I'd been working on my own novel for months. It sat beside my Corona portable number 3. All that I had written, the only form and place and way it existed in the world, was stacked there, in original and carbon copy, all the corners neatly squared, as was my custom at the end of each writing day. I stepped to the desk. I sat down. I laid my hand on the 20,000 or so words. I thought to pick up the first page and begin to read, but I did not. I sensed the writing was not going well. In a way not unlike what I'd seen of Ernie's work, mine had similar flaws. A certain voice, mine coming by way of the Chicago Post-Express copy desk instead of the Toronto Star, the voice of a guy who's got his eye on the big picture and knows it all already, and he wants to fill a 30-inch news hole that will start as the front page lead. I leaned forward over my typewriter and took up the photograph that I propped each day against my coffee cup. Bunky took it of me just after the invasion. He had it printed up on postcard stock for me. He'd caught me from behind. I was walking on the street. Dead Mexican snipers lay on the sidewalk. I was passing them without a glance. I looked now at the top page of my manuscript. The first few sentences spoke of how President Woodrow Wilson, on April 21, 1914, dispatched 1,000 American Marines and Blue Jackets to capture Veracruz. I had not consulted my own news coverage from that day in order to begin my novel, but I was only too keenly aware, beneath the pale gaslight in our rooms on the left bank of Paris, that these first sentences, and the rest of my sentences as well, were essentially interchangeable in voice with my journalism. I stood up. I extinguished the light. I moved to our bedroom and put my hand to the knob and began to open the door. Again, slowly, quietly. I expected darkness, but there was light. Louise was awake. She was shouldered back against the headboard. Her bedside reading lamp was lit. Of her face, I saw only her forehead and that her dark hair was let down. Held up before her was a magazine in plain tan covers, its name in red, The Criterion. Having snuck in so quietly, I was afraid to startle her. I hesitated, but she said without lowering the magazine, "I know you're there, darling kid. Just a moment." I waited, filled with the awed and vaguely intimidated tenderness I often felt for my own wife. She knew I was there. But she did not let on for a few long moments, as she was reading and would not yet be disturbed. Reading something heady, I was certain. She had waited up for me, though she needed her sleep and though I'd left her bed for the company of a man whose otherwise widely recognized charm was to her superficial and self-serving. And I was her darling, declared in a tone both tender and utterly convincing. Now the magazine came down. Her dark eyes were vast in the shadows of the lamplight, and I wished only to come to her and ask her to close them so that I could kiss their lids. But there was always something about her that made me happy to wait for her agenda. A thing the French called, with a shrug, je ne sais quoi. She said,
Sylvia gave me this new magazine. She is so dear and so smart. It has the most wonderful long poem in it by a Mr. Thomas Stearns Eliot.
She paused and patted the bed beside her.
Do divest yourself of shoes and most of your clothes and come lie here now.
This I did. She kept hold of the magazine with Mr. Eliot's poem the whole time, though in her lap. When I was settled beside her, she lifted the magazine a little and resumed.
He is a clerk in a bank of all things, but perhaps such a job can breed this dark view. He says that April is the cruelest month, and I know what he must mean. When the external world of rebirthing nature and the inner world of a depressed spirit are so at odds.
She paused to let me consider that, and I asked, such as the inner life of a fundraiser for a hospital, trying to trade war wounds for the traveler trots? At this she laid her magazine on her lap, letting it go. She took my nose between her middle and forefingers and not quite gently twisted, saying,
I read more deeply than that, my darling.
I rubbed my nose.
Did I hurt you?
She asked, not quite concernedly. No.
Good. So, what's Mr. Hemingway's ailment?
I told her the story. I omitted the woman in the dark coat. Nevertheless, her first words were,
He will make poor Hadley pay.
I suppose, I said.
One way or another, she said.
It will be undeserved, I said. She lifted her hand to my face. This time she touched my cheek with her palm, very gently.
I would not be so foolish with your words, she said.
I know, I said, and suggested she close her eyes for a moment. The next morning I stepped into a telephone booth at the post office and confirmed what I'd heard, that the State Department's Secret Service man at our Paris embassy was now James Metcalf. He was working out of the London embassy when I'd had need of him in the spring of 1915. He dispatched me to Constantinople for my first little adventure with the Turks. His voice boomed at me over the telephone wire as soon as his assistant put me on.
Kit Cobb, let me take you for food.
Gentleman Jim, I said, an old nickname he'd confided in me at our first meeting in Queenstown on the Irish coast after they'd fished me out of the North Atlantic. As long as the final course is some information, I said, I've got Turk trouble.
Again?
He said.
Food first.
The last time I saw him, he'd treated me to a 17-course dinner at the Carlton Hotel, whose chef was French, Monsieur Escoffier. Metcalf had his own family money and liked to eat. Now, in Paris, we arranged to meet for lunch in front of the La Pérouse, a restaurant in an 18th-century mansion looking from the left bank onto the Seine near the Pont Neuf. I waited, pondering the neighborhood. The hotel where I'd stayed during the mission that resulted in my meeting Louise was not much more than a brisk 5-minute walk away. Sylvia's bookstore was 10. Before me, in the river, was the Place Dauphine on the western tip of the Ile de la Cité, where the head of the French Secret Service had his low-profile headquarters during the war. Then Metcalf appeared, a great, bulging airship of a man. In these 7 years he'd gained 100 pounds upon his gourmand's body. He was indeed reminiscent of a craft that seemed impossibly lighter than air, for, in spite of his size, he strode quickly toward me and then moored himself upon my extended right hand with both of his, briefly shaking, but then holding fast for a few moments more, as if to resist lifting up into the air. We soon sat in one of the small parlor dining rooms, up a staircase that Metcalf could barely fit through. We ordered, and as we waited, I told him about Hemingway and his Turks. Every detail, except the woman in the black coat. Metcalf humphed and turned thoughtful, but our food came before he replied, and when it did, he acted as if he hadn't heard me. Instead, he mixed reminiscences of the Turks' offenses and Escoffier's triumphs, with particular emphasis, among the latter, on the ortolan bunting, a mouth-sized bird plucked and legless, but otherwise baked entirely whole, then put in the mouth, also entirely whole, and eaten, organs, blood, brain, and all. I knew to let him set the conversational agenda. He had his own ways, but I was never sure with Metcalf whether the food we shared, and he discoursed upon, was intended as a metaphor for whatever Secret Service business was at hand. At this lunch, after he'd waxed rhapsodic upon the cream and cognac and tarragon of the La Pérouse's langoustines we were then eating, he made clear that you had to kill these small fry lobsters from Norway just before you ate them, or the bacteria under their shells would go after you. He closed his eyes to savor the last morsel, and when he opened them again, he instantly said, "It sounds as though your friend's problem needs a quick solution. Do you know the Turk I described? Do you want some coffee?" I wasn't in the mood for more indirection. He picked up on my hesitation and smiled. "Any help my office can provide will come along with the brew. Just not from me. I send you now to a bistro in the Rue Blondel. They have good Turkish coffee, I understand, though I myself don't have a taste for it. The Turks, in their barbarism, would have you ingest as much grinds as liquid coffee. But our agent will meet you there. An agent new to us, but deep in knowledge of the Turks." Metcalf extracted his watch from a vest pocket, which took some serious effort and great strain on the gold chain. He looked at the time. "You're due at the bistro within the hour," he said. "I took the liberty of arranging the meeting as soon as you mentioned your Turk troubles on the phone." "How will I know him?" I asked. He smiled. "You'll be recognized." Metcalf would say no more on the matter, but gave me the Rue Blondel address near the Porte Saint-Denis in the 10th arrondissement. The street was narrow, the bistro was small, with only two tables outside, unoccupied in the chill of the cloudy December day. Just inside the door I stopped and did a quick scan of the place. It was low-ceilinged and smelled of garlic and onion. Immigrant smells. About half the two dozen or so small tables still held end-of-lunch patrons. I focused on the three that held solitary men. Two of them were clear working-class types in overalls, not likely our agent. The third was a man in a brown serge suit. He was sitting at a freestanding table near the center of the place, facing this way, focused on a tightly folded newspaper a little to the side of his coffee cup. He seemed to be the one. I waited for him to notice me. He wasn't moving. I took a step toward him, and another. He looked up, saw me, looked back down at once, not even a flicker of recognition. I stopped. I scanned the room again. The little groups were all engaged with each other. My eyes moved toward the back of the place, along the left-hand side, which was lined with a dingy mirror. There was one other person, alone there. I'd ignored her the first time around, as she sat with her back to the others, and she was dressed in widow's black with a cloche hat and a thick mourning veil. Now I realized that her head was lifted a little, and the veiled face was reflected in the mirror. From the angle, she was clearly looking at me. But the veil was down. There was no discernible face. And now the head nodded at me once, and waited. I looked around the room, quickly. Nothing had changed. I was still unanimously ignored, except by the widow. I stepped to her, stopped beside her table, still not sure. She inclined her head at the bench seat across from her. I sat beneath the mirror.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.